try to push more people to the front when they come in.
Huh?
The front? Opening up with some of the, but somebody told me I should really open up with a story. So I'm going to open up the story. And we'll find a way to work it in. So there's a story. How true it is, we don't really know. But supposedly one day, Napoleon was walking down the street, whether it was in Paris or someplace else, and all of a sudden he heard crying and wailing coming out of the synagogue. He didn't know what was going on. He asked his soldiers around him, you know, what's going on? What's going on in that building? You know, he was crying coming out. One of the soldiers, one of his attendants, happened to be Jewish, and he said, oh, today is a day of mourning for the Jewish people. They're crying. What are they crying about? You know, they had a temple that was destroyed. Temple where? Here in my city? I didn't hear about anything being destroyed. Where is it? You know, what's going on? You know, does the fire department know? You know, what's happening? Oh, no, it happened a long time ago someplace else. What are you talking about? Oh, about 1,700 years ago in Jerusalem. Napoleon's response was, if such a people can mourn their temple for 1,700 years, these people are definitely guaranteed to see it rebuilt. That was Napoleon's response. In fact, Napoleon, in 1799, tried to actually make it happen. He tried to conquer Jerusalem and have it, you know, and hand over Jerusalem and all of Eretz Yisrael to the Jewish people, but the British got there before him and beat him. And unfortunately, it didn't happen until later on. Now to the halachot, and we'll see how it ties in. Shulchan Aruch. Tisha B'Av. Obviously, he's not going to tell us we're not allowed to eat and drink, because that's a given. But he opens up. Asur, Birhisa, Visicha, Ul'ilat Asandab, Tashmisha Mitta. The same Inuim that were forbidden on Yom Kippur. Right? You can't wash, you can't anoint, you can't wear leather shoes, you can't have marital relations. But he adds one more. Vasur, Likrot, Batorah, Nibi'im, Uchtubim. You can't read Torah, Nibi'im, Uchtubim. And you can't learn anything either. No Mishnah, no Midrash, no Gemara, no Halachot, no Agadot, zero. The precepts of the Lord are just rejoicing the heart. Back then, there was no summification. Children would learn Torah 12 months out of the year. They had a day off. It was called Tisha B'Av. That was the day off. About Korehu b'Iyob b'Devarim ha'ra'ish b'Yirmiyah. V'yish b'nehem p'sukei nechama sarich dal legam. But what can you read on Tisha B'Av? You could read Iyob, and you could read the disastrous portions of Yirmiyah. And if you happen to chance upon any words of consolation, of composure, you have to skip them. And you could study the Midrash of Echa and Perek Il Migal Lahin. It's a section of the Gemara in Masech Mu'ayd which deals with Abilut. And you could learn the Pirush on Echa and Pirush of Iyob so you understand what you're reading. That's the first set of laws. The second set of laws. In she'elat shalom l'chaviro b'tisha'a b'av. You cannot greet one another on Tisha'a b'av. V'hedyotot she'enan yoda'im v'lodim shalom mishim lahem b'safar afa l'cho b'drosh. And hedyotot, simple people, people that don't know any better, and they happen to greet you, so you have to answer them. You can't be, you know, disgusting and lacking, you know, normal manners. So answer them, but answer them with a heavy heart. Lo yelech v'taleh b'shuk. You cannot go out to take a walk in the marketplace. Kedei shelo yevo l'idisehok v'kalut v'hitul. Because that also brings you enjoyment, laughter, frivolity, etc. Third set of halachot. Lev tish'a b'av v'yomo yoshbim v'bet ha'kineset la'aris ad tefilat mincha. From the night of tish'a b'av until mincha of tish'a b'av, you sit in the kines on the floor. Then in parentheses, ve'achshav nahagu leishev al safsalehem miyad ahar sheyasru bebet ha'kineset shahrit. U'ma'arichin imakkinot ad me'at kodem hasot. So, okay, yeah, you could sit on a chair, you could sit on a bench, after they leave the bet kineset for shahrit. But Shachrit doesn't end as early as you think, because you stretch out Kinot until just slightly before Hasot. So Hasot today is about 1 o'clock. You sit in darkness to read the Kinot at night. B'sha'at HaKinot, when you say the Kinot, asur l'saper davar. You're not allowed to talk whatsoever during the Kinot. And you can't go outside. And you cannot take your mind off of the Avilut whatsoever. You have to remain focused. That's what the whole day is about. So we have 6 laws that broke up into these 3 sections. You can't read Torah because it makes a person happy. And happiness on Tisha B'Av is forbidden. You can only study Yov, Echa, negative portions of Yirmiyah, and you can study all the commentaries involved. Anything that might make you happy, you have to skip. You cannot greet people on Tisha B'Av. If a person greets you, you can only respond with a lowered head and a heavy heart. You cannot go walking around leisurely in the market because it can lead to lightheadedness. You have to sit on the floor night and day to recite Kinot and Echa, and you have to remain on the floor until at least midday. And during Kinot, you cannot talk about anything or even to walk out in order to ensure that your mind stays focused on mourning. So here we are. You walk into this building today. What's going on out there, what I just read? Are the halachot consistent with what we see people doing? How do we have all these classes studying Torah? What are they studying? Are they studying things that are permissible to be studied or not? I don't know, so I'm not here to comment on those particular classes, but I know there are other classes elsewhere where they're not studying the proper things. But people are walking around very, very happy. People, each year I see it more and more, people are greeting each other, they have no problem shaking hands, high-fiving, laughing, joking, it makes no difference to them. The day of Tisha B'Av has no meaning to the common person. Hundreds of community members, okay, obviously we have about 3,000 in this building today, which is great, but hundreds and thousands more are walking the mall today, they're watching movies, they're at the movies, they're at home watching TV, they're hanging out with friends, or they're just sleeping the day away. You have to keep your mind focused on the Hurban. That's the point of the day. The Jewish nation suffered, has suffered, and we keep suffering. And we have to stay focused. It's our one day, it's a national day of mourning for that. What about all the people that attended services last night or this morning? Did they all sit on the floor or not? What's going on with that? Do the people pay attention to the Kinot? Do they understand the Kinot? Well, they're just bored. Are you bored? Am I bored? Am I sick and tired of year after year sitting down on the floor reading these Kinot that we don't know what they're about, where they came from? Maybe it's time we understood them. It's 1,948 years since the Beit HaMikdash, the second Beit HaMikdash, was destroyed. It's about time we understand what's going on. So in front of you, you have a sheet. If you don't have a sheet, there might be some more around. I might have a few more over here. Of two Kinot. Two Kinot, which I would like to examine together with you, if possible. First Kinah. Well, before we tell you what the first Kinah is, we have to know where the Kinot came from. So, like so many other things, among Sephardim and Ashkenazim, our prayers are different. Our tunes are different, our halakhot and minhagim are different, but the difference really stands out with Tisha B'Av. We do not have even one kina that's the same, not even one. The kinot of the Ashkenazim, for the most part, were composed by Bil Azar HaKadir. He lived about 500 years after the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash in Eretz Yisrael. So figure he lived from 570 to 640 in Eretz Yisrael. And almost every one of the Ashkenazi Kinot was written by him. Among the Sephardim, none of our Kinot comes from Bil Azar HaKadir. In the old days, they did, either from HaKadir or from Sa'adiyah Gaon. But with so many of our people moving into Spain and then moving out of Spain and into Arab lands, the Kinot from Spain took over. They basically pushed away all the keynote that was said beforehand and replaced them with keynote that becomes fitting. So our keynote begin with Biudeh and Levi, who lived about 900 years ago in Spain, and from other composers in Spain. Most of the composers we do not know. They were written at times when the composers themselves were massacred and killed. Now, before I continue, some people have asked me, well, if you say that keynote were replaced, does that mean we can replace our current keynote? Can we add keynote? Can we delete keynote? Absolutely, to all of the above. For a modern day example, in 1917, when the British took over Iraq, many Jews were killed. Rabbi Yitzhak Nassim wrote a keynote for the occasion. In 1941, there was the famous Farhud, also in Baghdad, Iraq, on Shavuot, where the entire Jewish community was plundered and hundreds of Jews were killed. Again, a keynote was written. In 1948, when the Arab Legion took over Jerusalem and destroyed it, the chief rabbi at the time, the Rishon Lezion Acham Ben Sion Mir Chai Uziel, wrote a keynote. With the Holocaust, keynote were written. Even by Sefer Adim, you'll see in the current Kol HaKahal, you'll see that Rabbi Greenwald brings Sefer Adim, who wrote a keynote for the Holocaust. Among the Ashkenazim, they're up in arms about it. Can we write keynote? Can we not write keynote? Because we're not on the level of HaKadir. Can we include new things into the keynote service or not? So there's different opinions. Some, of course, say that you can because it was such a tragedy. Some say otherwise. In any case, keynote can be added, keynote can be deleted, because it's to make you, me, you, and all of us connect with the day and what's going on. And the tragedy of the Beit HaMikdash is not just the Beit HaMikdash, but it's the ensuing tragedies of the Jewish people. On the flip side, though, when we got the State of Israel and we got Yerushalayim back, many people turned to Rabbi Chaim David HaLevi, who was chief rabbi of Tel Aviv, and they said, you know, Hacham, what's going on? Do we still have to mourn so much? He said, absolutely not. We have to stop cutting out keynote. And he was well known that if you went to his Beit Knesset on Tisha B'Av, he would say, we're not saying this, we're not saying this, we're not saying this, because, you know, things are getting better. So we have to lessen our mourning. And he actually put that into play, and people would go there on purpose because they wanted to say less and they wanted to feel the current state of the beginning of the Gibbutz that we're in. But we still have our keynotes, and we're still saying them year after year because we're afraid to change things around here. Our book of keynote has some keynote, so you have a sheet of paper there. One side has a keynote that we say. One side is a keynote that we no longer say. We're going to start with the one that we say, Boreh Ad Ana. Boreh Ad Ana is said in many traditions, but it was not originally composed to be said on Tisha B'Av. We just finished the saddest three Shabbatot of the year. These three Shabbatot are referred to as Taltad Qur'anutah. Okay, the three Shabbatot of retribution, where the Nebi'im in the Haftarot of these Shabbatot come down really hard on Am Yisrael. And they're very, very sad. And the whole message within these Haftarot is something that comes to play in certain keynote that were actually written for those Shabbatot. Yes, keynote were said on Shabbat. For three Shabbatot in a row, keynote were said on Shabbat in Spain. All the synagogues of Spain, and they brought it with them later on to Turkey, to North Africa, to Greece, to Italy, and to other places. And keynote continued to be said, as until maybe about 100, 150 years ago when they started cutting them out because they felt it was improper. But they still left tunes on these Shabbatot that were very sad. If they stopped saying the keynote, they would say Haftarot in special ta'amim just for these Shabbatot that were sadder than the rest of the year. Or in our tradition, you know, we have this workup to Tisha B'Av, we have our weekly ma'am, and we use sadder ma'amah. We're using the Hawand and Sava and culminating with Hijaz to get us into that mood of being said for Tisha B'Av. So this particular kina, Buri'a al-Anah, was written to be said in place of a Tahur Eta Tada'at. Tahur Eta, you know, we sing it with, before we're taking out the Sefer Torah on Shabbat. On Shabbat, in other words, yesterday it would have been, they would have said Buri'a al-Anah while taking, you know, while opening up the Hecha to take out, before taking out the Sefer. All we know about this piyut was it was written by Binyamin. We don't know his last name, we don't know exactly when he lived, but based upon the contents, and I'm going to point out something in particular to you, it was definitely written in light of the massacres in Spain in 1391. We'll call it the pre-Inquisition to the Inquisition. Think about this, Kina, we know it definitely came from Spain also because it carried through to practically every Sephardic community. From the Halabi community, to the Moroccan community, to the Livorno community, to the Turkish community. Each community had this, you know, kina among what they said. And the only way to trace that, you know, is because it came back to Spain. Otherwise, it wouldn't have the same thing. But what really clinches it is the tunes are very similar from country to country. So people saying, oh, we're saying Buri'a al-Anah, it sounds like the Kha'ili, you know, well, that doesn't sound like Kha'ili. The Kha'ili sounds like Buri'a al-Anah. Buri'a al-Anah, because so many countries have the same kina with the same tune, that means the Kha'ili copied Buri'a al-Anah. So this poem recounts the lamentable fate of the Yonah. The Yonah, we'll call him the dove, well, keep referring to him as Yonah, to which Shir HaShirim compares Am Yisrael. Gone are the days when God hid his beloved dove in the crevice of the rock to hide it from the venomous serpents. Persecuted, deprived of its little ones, exposed night and day to hardships and anguish, the little dove longs for reconciliation and redemption. We read here about the Yonah, the dove, which is used as a symbol of Am Yisrael, subjected to cold and heat, pursued, captured, slaughtered. The aspirations are for the day when it can fly freely once again. But realizing the reality at hand, just calls out to God to have mercy and compassion and to please bring final salvation to Bnei Yisrael. Before we jump into the kina, I want to read a midrash and see how the bird is viewed, and more specifically, the Yonah. Bayhi b'shallach paro. Hada hu d'chdib. Nafshenu kisipor l'netar yipach yomshim. So it opens up, it's from Midrash of Shemot Rabbah, it talks about Parashat B'Shallach, and it starts. Hada hu d'chdib. What's Vayhi B'Shallach Paro? What is Paro sent away? It refers to Pasuk in Tehillim, Nafshenu kisipor l'netar yipach yomshim. We have escaped like a bird from the fowler's snare. Mashal l'yonah sh'ayetah yoshev b'kina. He gave a parable. It's like a Yonah sitting in its nest. Ra'a utana hashra. Evil serpent saw it. Hayam bakesh la'alot ilayha. Obviously the serpent wanted to go up and eat it. Bar ha'imenu l'makum aher. And the bird flew away someplace else. Ala v'yashab la b'kina. The snake went up nonetheless and sat in the nest and said, okay, eventually the bird has to come back, I'll catch it then. Nafla ha'esh b'kina b'nisnafa nahash. Happened to be that it was a hot day, it was a dry nest, it went on fire, and the nest burnt, and obviously the serpent burnt with it. Parha ha'sipor v'yash b'la b'gad. Now the sipor, this yonah, this bird had no nest, had no more home. It went, flew up to a roof to live on this roof. Since the nest and the serpent were burnt, why are you still flying around, bird? The bird found another home, found a new nest, and settled there. So this is a mashal to the situation of Am Yisrael in Mitzrayim. Right? Am Yisrael was in Mitzrayim. Paro decided, let me make the best of the situation. Okay, I don't want them to get smarter than me. I'm going to be smarter than them. I'm going to put them into servitude. I'll take care of them.
ויאמר למשק הנחש, נאמר, מנבא על פרעה התנים הגדול. פרעה in יחזקאל is referred to as the great crocodile, the great serpent. ברחו ישראל מפניו. So we had יציאת מצרים, we escaped. שנאמר, יחרדו כסיפור ממצרים. וכיוון שיעשו ישראל ממצרים, נשרף פרעה באש. So how did פרעה now be like the serpent that was consumed in fire? שנאמר, תשלח ארונך יאכל להם בקש. God sent down his anger and he burnt them like straw, simply. יש בודהם ישראל במקום אחר. Someplace else, שנאמר, ויהיה סיפור בודד על גב. Like the bird sitting on the roof. ואחר כך ברחו כסיפור ממקום למקום. They kept traveling around the wilderness, right? שנאמר, כסיפור נודדת וכינה, כן איש נודד ממקומו. Keeps traveling, wandering around. וכשבאו לישראל, when they finally got to Israel, מסעו להם כן. They found for themselves a resting place. They found their nest. שנאמר, גם סיפור מסעו הבית. Now even the bird found its house. They found its home. וכן דוד אמר, עד אמצא מקום לאדוני, משכנות לאבי יעקב, וכך נאמר, נפשנו כסיפור לנטר. This is when we finally come home. So, if we've come home, should we still be saying these kinot? We have Eretz Yisrael now. We found our home. Looks like we're there to stay, hopefully. Can we stay? Can we still say it? We escaped. We escaped like the bird. We found our home. You know, I don't know. Can we still identify with these type of midrashim or with the kina borei adana that we're going to read now that was written about 625 years ago? Is our situation like their situation? How does it work together? How can we relate to it? You know, or should we just abandon it and say, it's enough, let's get rid of this kina, let's get rid of the next kina, and rewrite the book of kinot? Or think about how it still applies to us. So let's look at Borei Adana. You have the first stanza. Borei. It's calling out to Borei. Borei Adana. Adana. God, until when? When? What's going on? I've had enough of this. Yonatha b'msuda tofpacham mokesh aniyya umbuda ubli baneha yoshevet galmuda so'ikit abi. So, let's think of it like this. We're calling out to God and we're asking Him. Friday night we open up Lecha Dodi. Rosh Hashanah we open up Ahod Ketana. And Tisha B'Av, this is one of the opening Kinot Borei Adana. All three, because we have no other holiday we really open up except for Kippur when we start with a Midui. So that's why it's left out. So in all three of these, we call out from our exile and we're looking forward to redemption. If you go through the paragraphs of the Chaduli, we start with exile, move to redemption. Ahod Ketana, same thing. Borei Adana, same thing. They're all moving from exile to redemption. And we saw from the days of Shir Shirim, Am Yisrael is compared to the Yonah. But here he's saying enough. The author of this Kina is saying, I've had enough. The Jewish nation screams out to the Creator, we do not want to be a Yonah anymore. We scream out specifically to the Borei. Why Borei? Why is it open up Borei? Why is it open up Hashem? Why is it open up HaKadosh Baruch Hu or Sur Yisrael? Borei. Borei because He's responsible. He's responsible for creating. He creates everything, including the situation that we're in. He created it. The author of this Kina is throwing blame at Hashem. Pah u'mokesh ha'oni va'arirut, the trap and the snare of poverty and childlessness. They tie in perfectly to the Haftarot of the three Shabbatot that we just mentioned. The first section that we just said, and so'eket abi, right? The Yonah is calling out, so'eket abi, is crying out, abi, my father. What do we think about? Anybody? So'eket abi.
Akedat Yitzhak.
Very good, Akedat Yitzhak, excellent. So we have Akedat Yitzhak, is 19 Pesukim. And it's called Akedat Yitzhak. When do we hear Yitzhak? We hear Yitzhak once only in the 19 Pesukim. Vayomer Yitzhak el Aram Avi, Vayomer Avi, my father. And his father says, Hinei Bini. Hinei Shvahasim Vayeh Asir Awadah. Okay, Dad, what's going on over here? You know, you have the stuff, you have the fire, you have the wood. What's next? Where's the animal? What's going on? And the father says, what does Abraham Avinu say? Elohim yir'illoha seri'a ala bini. God's going to show us, don't worry about it. Ishaq says, Abi. Abraham says, Bini. But that's all we get. We get nothing else in the entire story. But where else do we have Abi? Even more. We have Abi with Elisha and Nabi. Sefer Melachim Bet. Elisha and Nabi was basically the right-hand man of Eliyahu and Nabi. He was with him all the time. He was his helper. He was his student. He relied on him for everything. He looked at him as his father. ויהי המה הולכים הלוך ודבר, והנה רכב אש וסוסי אש, ויפרידו בין שניהם. ויעד אליהו בסערה השמיים, ואלישע רואה, והוא מסעק, אבי אבי, רכב ישראל ופרשיו, ולא ראו עוד, ויחזק בבחדיו, ויקרעים לשניים כרעים. All of a sudden they're walking, and this chariot and horses of fire come swooping down, separate Eliyahu and Elisha. All of a sudden Eliyahu is on this chariot, headed towards heaven, never to be seen again. Elisha cries out, Abi, Abi, my father, you Eliyahu, you my father? You know, what's going on? He doesn't see him again, and he does kibihah. He rips his clothes, he's in mourning. Elisha is in mourning. He's mourning the loss of Eliyahu, who went up in this chariot, and what do you do? He called out Abi. The composer of the Kinah, he takes the timimut, the simplicity of Ishaq, okay, by saying, Dad, what's going on? And he takes the mourning of Elisha, asking for God to have mercy on him, and he combines them together. That's how he opens up the Kinah. The Kinot were meant for you to understand. You, the reader, should understand our history, our biblical history, to know what's going on. Either every one of these composers expected the reader to understand the nuances of the Hebrew words. The Boreh, you have to understand, he's talking to the Boreh as being the creator, of the situation at hand. You have to understand the Pahamokesh, you have to understand the Abi, you have to understand what's going on. They never imagined we would never understand anything. We barely understand the Hebrew words. Second paragraph. No, you're laughing, but it's very sad and it's true. The second paragraph starts, Na'a gam nada, mikina hayuna, ulkirah bihorib, yom ba'dai lahuna, himit harid, mihrib hayuna, mishine labi. Na'a gam nada. Right away, what do we think? Na'a banad ba'aris. Okay. Right, he's wandering to and fro. But did you think of that last night when you read it? Not at all. That's what I thought. You never thought you had to think about it. So, Na'aman, what happens? Cain kills his brother, and one of them tells him, that's it, you're stuck. From now on, you're going to be wandering to and fro throughout the country. And what's he wandering? And what's Cain's response? He's afraid of being killed. Here we are again. Am Yisrael, Na'agam Nada, and we're afraid of being killed. But the composer not only did that, he brings a reference to Yishak and Abraham in the first paragraph. Now he also brings us Yaakov Avinu. Ulkerach v'horeb yom v'layla hona. He finally, Yaakov finally is able to leave Laban, Laban ha'arami, who he worked for and killed himself for. And Yaakov, Laban comes chasing after Yaakov. He, no, you stole my stuff. He goes through everything. He didn't find anything. And Yaakov turns to him, you know, what do you want from me? مَا فِشْعِي مَا حَطَّتِي كِدَلَتَ أَحَرَي. What sin did I commit that you came chasing after me like I'm a criminal? He مِشَّشْتَ أَتْقُلْكِنَا. You went through all my things. مَا مَسَاتَ مِكُلْ كُلِ بِتَيْخَ. Did you find anything that belonged to you? سِمْ كُنِغِ الْأَحَيْبِ أَحَيْخَ بِيُخِيْخُ بِنِشِنِهُ. Put it here in front of everybody. Let them determine. Let them see who the things really belong to. I've worked for you 20 years. Nothing. I didn't even eat one of your animals. Nothing. And then he continues.
Hayiti bayom akhalani hawli.
Bekirah bil layla. متداش نتيم عناية continues. I don't know if we're reading the rest of the Pisukim. But here we are. The original person that chased the Jews, right? Laban chasing Yaakov, he's chasing the father of the Shebatim, chasing the Jewish people. Laban is causing hardship to Yaakov. He tells him, Hayti bayyom, atalani hore bikirah balayla. Often, scorching heat ravaged me by day and frost by night. But at least he, Yaakov, he knew. He knew what was coming. Winter, he expected this. Summer, he expected that. But we, as Am Yisrael, we as the Yonah in this particular Kina, we're the ones who are constantly suffering. We suffer through heat and frost day and night. We never know when it's going to hit us. We never know when the powers, you know, at hand decide. Third paragraph. Yeah. Eid azabta. Utabiyat turif. Afal as-safar. Umalaka urif. Abru as-shanim. Gam kais gam horif. Isa ud oibi. What's happening over here? The poet, Binyamin, doesn't give up. He's defiant. God. Yeah, God. You left the Yonah to be devoured. To be devoured by strangers again and again. It's like a bad dream. It keeps recurring. You go back to sleep, same dream. Again, same dream. It keeps coming back. Just like the story of Yosef. But it's not just recurring like Yosef. He uses the Lashon from Yosef. It says, Beyad Toref, which reminds us of Tarof Toref Yosef. Yaakov, when he's given the cloak of his son Yosef soaked in blood, Beyakira, Beyomer, Ketonet Beni, Haya Ra'a Achalatu, Tarof Toref Yosef. He recognized it. He said, my son's tunic. A savage beast devoured him. Yosef was torn by a beast. And later on, when they wanted to take Binyamin down to Mitzrayim, Yaakov can't forget it. He turns to Yehuda and he says, "Vayeseha yehad biiti ba'omar ach tarof torah velori iti ba'hinna." Again, my son, my beloved Yosef, was torn apart by a beast. Here we go. He's telling you, "Ota biyat torah." You're taking him, and these people are beasts. They're going to kill us all. They're going to take this plain, simple Yonah, and rip it apart. But that's not all. It continues. The final line of that third stanza, Gam Kais Gam Horif. Gam Kais Gam Horif also should remind us of something in the stories of Bereshit. It takes us back to the world order in the days of Noah and the flood. They came out of the Teva. What did Borei Olam promise them? He said, "Od kol yemei ha'aretz zera v'kasim v'kor v'chom v'kayis v'chorev v'yom v'layla lo yishbodu." As long as the earth endures, God is making a promise. Planting time, harvest time, cold, heat, summer, winter, day, night, shall not cease. Nothing is going to cease. But what's the nothing? It's a promise from Borei Olam that the earth will always follow a set order. He put Mother Nature into play. There will never be anything to come to devastate the entire earth. But read it carefully. He's making the promise that there's a never-ending cycle. And this is what our composer is coming back to. The Yonah feels a never-ending cycle. A cycle of being chased, of captured, of killed, of eaten again and again throughout every generation, throughout history, throughout every country that we're in. This is what's happening to us. Enough, I've had it. But that means at the same time that God's grace and kindness will never falter either. God, same way you had mercy on the world, it's time to have mercy on us, on the Yonah. Again, our composer here, Binyamin, is very, very smart. He knows how to play all the different stories of the Tanakh, all the different nuances of the world, of the different words, and to bring them to Borei Olam, show Borei Olam that he's right, he as being the, what do you call it, the ambassador of Am Yisrael, and you, Borei Olam, you unfortunately, I'm sorry, I disagree with you, it's time that you change your tune and help us out already. Fourth paragraph, Mi ten eleha, eber hennesharim, la'uf bichba'ot, udhaleh biharim, la'bo'im doda, il tocha hadarim, al ishkach osbi. Me, 10 Eliyah. That's it, God. I had enough. I do not want to be a Yonah anymore. I know I've said it, you know, three previous paragraphs, but now I'm telling you, Eber Kanesharim. I want to be a Nesher. Nesher is commonly thought to be an eagle. It's not an eagle, it's a griffin vulture. Okay? Anyway, so whether or not it's a large bird, we'll leave it as that, and a very strong and mighty bird. Va'omar, Pasuk in Tehillim says, Va'omar mi yitin li Eber Kayona a'ufa ve'eshkona. So David HaMelech, nice guy. Oh wow, I wish I had the wings of a Yonah. I would fly away and find rest. But Yishaya says otherwise. Vikoye Adonai Ya Halifu Khowah Ya'adu Eber Kandesharim Yarusu Veloy Gau Yelifu Veloy Yafu. Vikoye Adonai, those people who have trust in Borei Olam. Hashem likes those people. He's going to renew their strength. Ya halifu khawah. Ya adu ever kanesharim. They're going to grow new wings. But not just any wings, like a nation. Like this nation, this vulture. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall march and not grow faint. The composer is telling us, I do not want. I don't want the wings of this Yonah, of this dove. I don't want to be sheathed in silver and gold. It all looks nice and well, but it's impractical. Okay? Just like back to the concept of Shira Shirim, Tore Zahab, and Mikudot HaKasif. It's not for me. I don't want the pretty. I want the might. I want the power. I want to stop being chased. I want to come in and be, you know, the vulture, the king. The poet here combines what Yishaya is saying and what Tehillim is saying, who both use the term Eber. But I don't want to be silver and gold and fragile, Yonah. You know what? Because I trust in God. Since I trust in God, I put my trust in you all these years. I've never given up. I've never faltered in my dedication to you. Okay, as such, it's time for you to renew my strength like a nation. I don't want to run and fly away. The Yonah, it's enough. It's time for a promotion to move me up to be a nation. I want to be the nation that we read about in Ha'azinu. Last night and this morning, we also read Ha'azinu. But nobody paid attention to that either. You just read through it. I want to be like you, Borei Olam. The nation is hovering over its nest, protecting its children. Borei Olam, I want to be like you. I want to be a nation just like you. I don't want to run away and have to hide someplace. That's what our composer is telling us again and again. It's equally interesting that all the wording of the stanza is reminiscent of Shir Shirim. But there it speaks of a frail, loving Yonah. Here the poet is saying, I don't want to be loving, I want to soar. I want to be up on the same level as you, Borei Olam. I want to be a vulture, I want to have royal status. Now he really gets crazy. Yo'asim Adeh, this fifth paragraph, I don't know how people miss it. Yo'asim Adeh Isot Ki Anusha Zarim Akhzarim Samua Hagusha Be'ol Kabed Be'hirpa Ugusha Gadol Mach'ubi. They devise a plan. Yo'asim Adeh devise a plan against her until she is mortally wounded. Zarim Akhzarim, cruel strangers, have weakened her with a heavy yoke. Be'ol Kabed Be'hirpa Ugusha, with reproach and disgrace, Gadol Mach'ubi, my suffering is great. You see the piece of paper in your hand? You see the book of Tisha B'Av that you read last night, this morning? They're all wrong. They're all wrong. This is not the Kina that was written by Binyamin. This is the Kina that the censors want you to have. This paragraph was changed. When BSC and Teva were reprinting and they made their books, I told them to change it. They were afraid. They're still afraid of the censors today. So great must have been the suffering inflicted upon the Jews in Spain at the hands of the Christians at the time this Kina was composed, that it contains this rarity among rarities in Jewish liturgy. I've never found anything, and I've looked. Believe me, I've been looking for years to find such a thing. Wait till I tell you what it really says. It's a forthright indictment of persecution by Christians, and has been censored in all editions of the fast day ritual, save for a few rare rare copies that were not caught, as well as some manuscripts that escaped from Spain. The original wording, first line is correct. Yuasim aliyah isot hi anusha. But then it continues. Sarim ha'ubidim ididim shilusha. Ab bin faruah. Ki in lahim busha. So now we'll reread it in English. They devise a plan against her until she is mortally wounded. Enemies. Enemies that worship three gods, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, because they have no shame. This is the Qinaa that was written. And if anybody wants to see a censored copy, black that by the censor, I brought one with me. And you could see how it's blacked out. Burnt out of the page. These are our enemies. These are the people that we think they're going to save us in the next election. Yeah, right. The sixth and final paragraph. This is the Nehama, or so we hope. Nahir Alibba il Shokhir bin Rumim. Dabir Nehama Alib Abunim. Kabesh bin Dahim. Pizurim Ba'amim. Bihuel Tabi. The poet finally brings us back to the subject of Ibla. If you recall, when we read the Halafot, said that at the end of the Kinot, you bring Yehuda. You have to bring some sort of Nehama. So some people do it at the end of all the Kinot, some people do it at the end of each one of the Kinot. We have a mixture in our books. But the poet brings us back to the subject of Yehuda. God, you are our only Savior. It's time to redeem us. It's time for Kibbutz Galuyot. You've seen what they've done to us. Time and again, they're out to destroy us no matter what. Nahem Alibba is exactly the hope we need. It's exactly the Haftarah of next Shabbat. It's exactly what we're going to say now in Mincha, Nahamu, Nahamu, Ammi. After we finish the Amidah, we're going to read Pesukim of Nehama. Nahamu, Nahamu, Ammi, Yomar Elo Yechem, Dabbiru Alev Yerushalayim. Our poet, Binyamin, he's very courageous. He's very daring. At times, even defiant towards God as he loathes the duty of the Yonah. But so often, his defiance, but to soften his defiance, our poet climbs the highest trees. He bases himself upon our forefathers and on ancestral lineages and the constellations of Yishaya. He turns to a request for shelter. Shelter under the wings of the poets of Tehillim and Shilashidi. And wishes to remind once again about the natural world order as promised at the end of the story of the Mabul. So everything comes together. All the stories of Bereshit, all of Tehillim, Shir HaShirim, Yishaya, history, everything comes together in one little piece of poetry that we read through in about a minute last night and didn't pay attention to. Question is why? And should we keep saying it? Now, we could discuss that. You know, if you have questions, answer type of thing, or we can go to another Qinaa, which is on the other side of the paper. What do you guys want to do?
Another
Qinaa. Another Qinaa. Simple. Another Qinaa we're not going to examine as much as this first Qinaa. The next Qinaa does not appear in the book that you use today. But it appeared in the tradition, just not in the Hebrew. It appeared in Arabic. Yes. Kinot didn't have to be said in Hebrew. Kinot could be said in another language. You're not forced to say your prayer, because it's not a prayer. It's you crying out to God. So this Kinot is a story about Hannah and her seven sons. It's a very famous story. It's in the Gemara, in Masechet Gittin, and it appears again in Midrash Echa. The story is very simple. You've all heard it before. There's a woman. She has seven sons. The Caesar captures them and tries to get each one of the sons to bow down to his idol. They all refute him with a different pasuk. He's losing face. By the seventh and youngest son, he can't take anymore. He tries to devise a plan. I'll throw a ring on the floor. You'll pick it up. Everybody will think you're really bowing down. They can give it to me, etc.
the seventh son, who was under 3 years old, seems to be the wisest of them all, puts the king in his place, shambles him to no end with pasuk after pasuk, proving that nothing, you know, that there's nothing to you, there's nothing to your religion. But to hear his words are just amazing. So I'm just going to jump forward, not to the section in the Gemara, but to the section in the Midrash Echa, talking about the seventh son. I'll read it to you, and I'll explain some portions, then we'll jump back to the Kinah. Hosea Shibi'i, V'hu haya qata shebekulla. He brought out the seventh of Hannah's sons, or in the Midrash, she's not called Hannah, she's referred to Miriam, but Nahton. So Gemara refers to her as Hannah, and the Midrash refers to her as Miriam. But he brought out the seventh son. It's the same story with the same pesukim. Amar, Beni, Ishtahavi Lasir, my son, bow down to the idol. Amar lo, Haz b'shalom, no way. Amar lo, Lama, Amar lo, Shekin kiti b'toratenu. וידעתה היום בשבותה אל לבביך כי אדוני הוא האלוהים השניים מעל ותחת עם עוד. It's not happening. There's only one God. He's the God. He's in heaven. We worship him. Nobody else. Nothing doing. I'm not worshiping the idol. ולא עוד שנשבענו לאלוהים שאין אנו ממירים אותו באל אחר. We already promised God that we will not replace him with any other God שנאמר את אדוני האמרת היום. וכשם שנשבענו לו, כך נשבענו שאין ממירנו באומה אחרת. And he promised us that as long as we stick to him, he's not going to replace us with another nation. שנאמר, ואדוני האמיר אתך היום. אמר לו קיסר. So the Caesar responded to him. אחיך, סבו ימים וסבו חיים וראו טובה. Your brothers, they're all older than you. They had a full life, they enjoyed life. You know, they got, you know, they saw so many good things. You're a little kid. Atat katan. Lo sabat yamim, velo sabat hayim, velo ra'ita tov ba'olam. You didn't have a chance to taste any of the goodness of life. Yishtahaveh l'serim, ve'aseh etmecha tovot. Bow down, and I'll do good things for you. I'll take care of you. Amar lo kiti b'toratenu. Adonai yimloch le'olam va'ed. Nothing doing, kid. We have one king, Borei Olam. He rules forever. Ve'omer, Adonai Melech Olam Ba'ed, Abdu Vo'im Arso. Not only that, Atim Betelim, Ve'oyeva Betelim. King, you're nothing. You're annulled. You're zero. Imagine a little king saying this to the king. Basar Vadam, Hayom Hay. Okay, you're flesh and blood, you're living today. U'mahar Met, tomorrow you're dead. Hayom Ashir, U'mahar Ani. Today you're rich, tomorrow you're poor. About a kadosh baruch hu hai v'kayam l'olam l'olmei olamim. Nothing can put down God. He's everlasting, ever living. Amar lo kesar. The Caesar responded. Re'a hayecha harugim l'fanecha. Don't you see your brothers? They're all murdered in front of you. V'harei mashlich tabati l'haris l'fnei ha-selim. I'm going to throw down my ring down in front of the selim, in front of the idol. V'havgiha. כדי שידעו הכל ששמעת לקולי. And lift it up so they all know that you listen to my words. אמר לו, חבל עליך קיסר. Caesar, you're a really חזיד case. Really, you're a zero. מה אם אתה מתיירא בבני אדם שכמותך? You're the Caesar and you're afraid of the people that are standing here with you? אני לא אתיירא במלך רכי המלכים הקדוש ברוך הוא אלוהי העולם? I'm not going to be afraid of בורא עולם. Who created everything, he's the real king. Amar lo, v'chi yesh elohu ala olam, how could there be really a king, a god forever? Amar lo, alilai alecha kesar, oh woe to you, Caesar. V'chi olam shelefkir haita, do you see nothing in this world? Amar lo, v'chi, then he goes through, you know, pasuk, back and forth, they keep nailing each other. And the little kid goes to every pasuk in Tehillim that you could imagine, of Tehillim, and Zechariah, and Bereshit, and Yishayah, and Iyob, and he keeps hitting him over the head. The king gives up. The king is humiliated. And he says, you know what? I can't take it anymore. I'm going to have to kill you. So what happens? Miyad gaza alav barabu. No, we have to kill him. That's it. Enough's enough. Amra lo immo. Okay? So the mother now turns to the king.
please, king, tenai bini ba habbiki wa nashiki, at least let me hug my son, let me kiss my son. Madnuala, okay, you could have your son for a little while. Ve'usiyada deha ve'nikatu halab, and she nursed him a little bit. That tells you how young he was. Amralu, ba'hayir wa shifat kisar, ul ghiri tahila, please, king, kill me first. Ve'hakahu gil, then kill him. Amralu kisar, ain show me yara, I'm not listening to you. You know why I'm not listening to you? Well, you kept telling me about your Torah. You know what your Torah says? Shor oseh oto ved beno lo tishhatu biyom ehad. No, you can't kill, what do you call, the animal and its child on the same day. So if I kill you, I can't kill your son. So I'm going to have to kill your son first, then I can kill you. It's not a problem. Amru lo, shulteh sheba'olah. You did, you idiot. Kevar kiyam tekol mizvot. You fulfilled all the mizvot in Torah. It's the only mizvah you have left that you didn't fulfill. Obviously, he couldn't stand this woman. He killed the child. So, obviously, the son is now killed. The mother falls upon him, and she cries out to him. Bini, my son. Go, when you get up to Shamayim, go to Abraham Abihir. This is what my mother has to say to you, Abraham. Don't think you're so great. Don't take it, you know, get a little haughty about it that you built a Mizbeah and you did Akedah Yishak. Ve'edeta Yishak bin. Hare, immenu banta shib'a Mizbahot. My mother, she built 7 Mizbahot. Ve'alta shib'a bani biyom ehad. She brought 7 kids up one day. Atani sayon, you only a test. You never killed your son. You never did anything. Ba'ani ma'asir. I'm actual proof. My mother did it. My mother let each and every one of us go. She taught us the right way and she let us all go. Aisha yita min shakatu mehabadatu. Gaza'ala ba'aru alayh. Bekeba shinihira sa'aru ha'kharin shinwata shinwata kinok. And it goes through all the thing. And then at the end, the mother got, you know, walked up to the roof and she jumped down from the roof. She killed herself. Ubat kol yosed ve'omeret em habbanim simehah. Beruah ha'kodesh sabahat ve'omeret al illa ani bochiyah. In the end, who's the happy person? Borei Olam calls out the mother of these children. She's the one that's happy. She's the one that raised the children to know what to believe in and what not to believe in. Where to give in and not to give in. And this is what Borei Olam is crying about. The kina. Now, if you look at that page with the kina on it, you look at the kina. It's only 6 stanzas. In the Arabic and Aramaic originals, it's 31 stanzas. Okay, and it's still read. It was read in Brooklyn. It was read in Deal. It's read in Kinis Addis. It's still read in Arabic year after year. If you look at this kina, it starts, Bat Ammi, Tegedil Bihoneha, daughter of my nation. Okay, the daughter, the woman, she's the one that raises the children. She's the one that raises them up and teaches them what the Torah is all about and what the fundamentals are, what the beliefs are. And she is the one that's wailing in her sorrow. And this is a story about Hannah and her 7 children, because all 7 of them were killed in one day in front of her own eyes. And it goes on, but if you look at the third paragraph, you have the first mistake. Just to point out some mistakes, since we pointed out censorship before, I want to point out some mistakes. Third paragraph starts, Lassa'ir, Patah Zaha Azar. But if it's Patah Zaha Azar, it has to be the Bechor. So this paragraph has to be La Bechor. Okay, and you can tell also because it says, I didn't read the Pesukim, but the Pesukim of the Bechor was, I'm not going to bow down because the Pesuk says, Anochi Almai Lech Hashem Satif HaMinesh Mishai. Okay, over here, tells you over here, Ech Ezov El Bechura Ne'ezar. How am I going to leave the God that's known through his strength? He's known through his strength because he took us out of Eretz Mishai. The second one, Belashini, we know it's correct, Lashini. He tells you over there, Lo Ebod, on the third line, Lo Ebod, Ki Im Le Yahid HaShokhin B'Mu'ono. If you look at the source in the Gemara and the Midrash, it tells you that the second son's pasuk that he used, Lo Ye Lefa Elohim Achirim Al-Panai. That's the Yahid. No other God. The next paragraph starts with Lashki Lishi, and that's a mistake. It has to be either to Lassair or Lakatan, the youngest one, because over here it tells you, Na'am Kah Tabba'ati. Take my ring. And that's the only one that he offered the ring to bow down. And then finally the Kina ends, Kol Nishma. Kol Nishma. A sound, a voice was heard, Soveyah Bim'ona, calling out from the heavens, Ashrechem Shib'atchem Nineh Hanna. How lucky, how praiseworthy are you, you seven children of Hanna. Nahalatchem Be'gan Aydin Mukhana. Your portion in Gan Aydin is prepared for you. Abartem Elohechem Bimunah, you served God faithfully. Ve'em Semeha, like we read in the Pasuk, Em Habarim Semeha. Ve'em Semeha, not only you are going to Gan Aydin, but Ve'em Semeha Be'aydin in Nineha. And also the mother is also in Gan Aydin with her children. Be'ezrat Hashem, this will be the last Tisha B'Av, and we can all be happy in Gan Aydin Aliyun. Amen.